Hello, hello. Hopefully there's comments. I'll wait till someone hops on to start commenting. Two disclaimers or warnings. My house is under construction, so if you hear weird stuff, that's what it is. And number two is my allergies are insane. So the sniffing and the hopefully no nose rubbing will go on in this live video. But other than that, I think that we're good to go. And on time. It's the right day. Those are wins already. Okay, Terry, if you're on here, Emily, anyone, will you guys comment or give me some hearts just so I can see comments? And if this doesn't work, then I will just, okay, yay. Hi, okay, here we go. It's working. Okay, so what I'm gonna start talking about, I wish I would have known I was doing this earlier. Hey guys. So I could have you guys submit questions. So feel free to ask questions as we go. I'm just gonna give you kind of a whole rundown of this makeup and just some fun ways that maybe give you inspiration on how to sell it. Hey Mandy, hey Adrian. And we'll go from there. So what I want to start with is less is more. So the quickest way, we all know the quickest way between two points is a straight line. So I want you guys to think about that when you're doing your makeup. Anytime you're using a product that has texture in it prior to makeup, the more work you're gonna have to do. I know it sounds counterintuitive, but it's true. So I like to take a clear and clean sunscreen that does not add texture to my skin whatsoever, because the older I get, the less texture my skin can handle, the less product my skin can handle. And really is the truth for everyone, no matter your age. But the younger and more perfect your skin is, the older and more perfect your skin is, the more you can get away with as far as makeup goes. So just understand that the beauty of creams is that they don't oxidize and they don't settle into the skin. So whatever product is in liquid foundations, BB creams, CC creams, because they do set on the skin, they will oxidize on the skin as well. So a lot of times people will, you know, you'll do your makeup in one mirror and then you look at it in another mirror and it just looks bad. Usually that has to do with oxidation. And so just knowing that is kind of helpful and exciting, knowing that our products are not going to do that to you. So I'm just gonna get going. Okay, let's see if you have any questions. I am adding a touch of glow illuminator to my satin lip and cheek. Oh, I bet that's so pretty. Which sunscreen do you like? So this is the one I get off of Amazon. It's just, I feel like this is a Japanese product, but Korean and Japanese sunscreens are pretty amazing. They cut rays that our sunscreens don't cut. And they're also just very, you can see how clear and clean that is. So this is kind of how my setup goes. Everyone's setup can be different. I like to have versatility in my palette, and I really do love this palette the best for me personally. Morning. When I am selling makeup though, I usually try to get people into the palette 12. I'll rarely try to get someone into this big of a palette. I feel like they kind of have to work up to that unless they're begging for it. You know, of course I try to read the room, but I find that the palette 12 is kind of a universally good palette, because without knowing the magic of 3D and having, where's my water? Oh, there it is. I think you need to be able to have all your eyeshadows and everything in one to kind of really feel the magic of the compact. And so that's why I'm just going to go into our brow wax. So that's why I like to get someone into a palette 12. Now, that doesn't mean that I haven't done videos and done things where I try to just get someone into a palette 4, because I feel like that's kind of a gateway. And honestly, they can get away, and I have often gotten away with those 4 colors. So that is a really fun way to sell also. I've heard through the grapevine that that's how Marcy Dixon likes to sell. She likes to sell the palette 4. I don't know what brush she likes to sell. If you guys know, let me know. But I'm more of a let's get them into a palette 12 kind of gal. But that doesn't mean that everyone, you know, there's a right or wrong with this. There is not. I think the key to online selling and to selling in general is just kind of being honest about what you like, because that's kind of what people are after when they're watching you, is they want to know what you like, what you do. And so if it's something that you like and you do, then that's how you should sell. Okay, I'm just gonna go into basic and just give my brows a little bit of color. Okay, so I need to look at my list. All right, so let's talk about, unless I see any, was sunscreen light? Okay, if I see any other questions, but I'm just gonna keep going. So let's talk about color theory a little bit. So when I talk about the shortest distance between two points, I like to talk about color theory and why color is so important, and why at Saint we're so focused on color. And that is because that is really where the magic lies with makeup. Textures, let's talk about cream texture first, and then we'll go into. So I think I kind of touched on most of why creams are amazing, but the other thing is you can place them in different places and they won't meld together. So you could try to do, you know, a few different colors in like a liquid situation, but because those colors absorb into the skin so fast, that's why I was actually shocked, because it had been so long since I'd used a liquid foundation. And so I was like, I just gotta go get one. I wanna do a video about liquid foundation. I'm gonna start contouring. If you have questions, let me know. I'm gonna be using Astoria and Bella. So I like to use Astoria right up here on my forehead. And then I like to use Bella on the sides, because you can kind of see as people get older, they get thinner skin, especially in this area. And so I just like to warm it up and not use contour there. But I do like to use warmth, because I, like a lot of people will tell you not to contour here, and that's also can be correct. But I'm gonna come in with Bella, warm it up, and then I'm going to come in with some correctors and get rid of these veins. Okay, so if we know that placing color is very important, what I just did, for example, how I went in with Astoria on my forehead, the top of my forehead, and then I went in with Bella on the sides of my forehead, it's just kind of that is kind of the essence of what makes this makeup great, is that you have the versatility to do that. Okay, so another, like, for example situation is, so if you already have somewhat of a shadow here, what I've been liking to do is take a warmer color, especially as I get older, just taking warmer colors where there's already shadows and just kind of utilizing that shadow, but just warming it up. So the shadow's there. It's just that I'm gonna utilize it and warm it up so that it creates kind of a balance in my face. Sorry about the allergies. Okay, so then, and you guys do know that I like to start, here's another versatility thing. You can do your makeup however you want with creams. What I like to do is I like to start, I'm gonna take my Bella under my lip. I like to start, I call it Brontour, I love that. I like to start with my darker colors and work my way to my lighter colors. I find that this technique sort of warrants me to be able to wear less makeup and get further with my makeup. Now, I know that not everyone does that, nor does everyone like to do that. And that's another reason I love this makeup, is because you don't have to. Like, you don't have to do your makeup the way I do it. Leo's been getting into my brushes, you guys. I'm doing like Mario and Luigi makeup. So this is what we're dealing with right now. Anyway, I'm doing this. I saw this Hailey Bieber look that I'm gonna do today. So she has a pretty distinct outer contour lip in the video, or the video in the picture, which I could show you, but it's on my phone. Anyway, so I'm just going to contour first. If you have any questions about contouring, let's talk about it. So basically, I'll just hit my main soapboxes. Hi, Snow. Anything you want to make look shorter, you're going to use more vertical or more horizontal lines. So anything you want to make look fuller, you're also going to use more horizontal lines. If you want to make something look longer, you're going to make a vertical line. So my nose being an example of that. So I want my nose to look thinner and give it length. So I'm going to come in with my contour and my brush, and I'm going to just take, what I like to do is kind of imagine the tiniest line right here. And I can just hold this here so you guys can see this, because maybe while you're practicing, you want to hold this tight line right here, and you can just go right up against it, just like so. And you're going to do that on the other side as well. Like that, and you got your two lines, okay? And all we're doing with these lines, you guys, is we're just creating an illusion. This is not reality. We all know it's not reality. And we also aren't trying to change our faces. We're just trying to create, I could have held that a little straighter, maybe. We're just trying to create the illusion of something a little bit more flattering. That's really all I'm doing here. And so when people go wrong with nose contour, a lot of times it's because they're trying to change something too much, or they're trying to, you know, people can do a lot in a ring light and make it look good. So they're just following, maybe you're following someone that's, you know, essentially not giving you the full spectrum or the full truth of what it actually looks like when they're done with their nose contour. So my goal always is to just change things ever so slightly so that they look better, but they don't look weird in different lighting. So you can kind of see how much smaller that made my nose look, only because it's making your eye I've just created a situation in which your eye is seeing more of this than it's seeing of anything else. And so by eliminating that light, I create a shadow. Okay, so the trick though is if you already have like a lot of blueness or shadows on your nose, like I have a lot of blueness and shadows right here. So I'm gonna go in with Bella right there. And the good thing about that is no matter which way I turn, I've just created a situation in which it's going to look good in person. That's really always my goal, is that it will look great in person. So holding that line tight is really important. And the other thing is, if you're wanting to create a longer, thinner situation with your nose, you're gonna use more vertical lines. If you're not, like let's say your nose is already long and smoke and mirrors, yes, but it does work. Then coming to the edge and kind of doing that horizontal line, and then maybe like making a little baby horizontal line here is going to look really great with your bone structure. So just keep that in mind when you're doing makeup. Okay, because I'm going after a look, I'm going to use this Laura Mercier eyeshadow primer. And you guys can see how I have this little discoloration. I have a lot of discoloration in my lids. And that's just my lids. Not everyone has that. I don't love it, but you guys will kind of see how I'm going to show you how to kind of deal with that. Not that everyone has it, but even when I put this primer on, which I really like, and it has a color to it, you can still see a little bit of discoloration. So you've got that, you can see that I have like a darker shadow here, and then here I have this really light shadow. I just have it's called vitiligo. And I have it, and when the summer hits, it's more obvious. So I try not to put that primer there because it's lighter anyway. And so I don't want to exacerbate the lightness of that spot in my eye. On the outside of those two small lines, top of your nose, do you? Honestly, Snow, that's a really good question. If I were taking a long time to contour my nose, I may go down the sides of it. But because I want this to be quick, I am not going to do that, because you can go, there's more room for error that way. So what I like to do is just kind of create a shadow that you can barely see and be done with it. But there's not really a right or wrong with that scenario. Just remember that the lightness here that you see, because I've seen so many people on YouTube and TikTok and whatever come in with that lighter shadow here, and it seems to blend them into their under eye, and that looks really pretty. So I guess it depends on what you're doing here. So if you have a lot of freckling and a lot of melasma through here, then you wouldn't want to do that, because it would be counterproductive, because you'd end up with more texture through this area. So I would say go darker that way. So like someone like me, you can see how I'm a little bit dark through here. And so I think if I put something light there, too light, it wouldn't look as pretty. So it has to do with your bone structure and what you want your end result to be. So I'm just going to continue to add my dark colors, and then I'm going to go in with my light colors. So I just did my nose contour. Now I'm going to go down the sides of my neck. So I like to go just down through here. This is Astoria. And I like to, this is how I like to kind of blend my face into my neck. My neck tends to not get a lot of color no matter what. So I don't like to kind of look like a bobblehead. The other thing as you can see, I already have a shadow here, so I can take a little bit of Ella and I can warm that up. Something I've been doing a lot of the last 2 years is just warming myself up as opposed to contouring a lot, because I'm getting a little bit older. And so I just want more volume than I used to want. So I'm just using Astoria here and kind of doing that little Nike swoosh situation, looking pretty. Okay. So now I'm going to come in with a blush. The look I'm going for has like a nude lip, a brown eye, like a light brown eye, a little wing, and I would say a more nude blush. So I'm going to come in to, they all look, kind of look the same. Ibiza, which I absolutely love. And I'm just going to add this color. Now, don't stress if you have rosacea. Let's talk rosacea. So if you have rosacea, a lot of times you're going to have a lot of that reddish purple undertone in your cheeks. I kind of challenge you to start in with blush first before you go covering your rosacea, and just see if you can change the tone rather than try to cover it with a color, with your more orangey colors, like Frenchie, for example, is a killer color for that. So if that doesn't work, obviously I don't have your face. And so I'm not saying don't do what you're doing. If what you're doing is working, do that. All right, I'm gonna come in with Chai. And I don't really want, you guys, I don't really want this just to be like a demo. So questions are very, Madrid works well too, Mandy says, and I believe her. So what I also like to do with my eyeshadow, and it's not something everyone does, but I like to blend that into my nose, especially if I'm using a color like Chai. Because it just allows me to be able to do that. So it just kind of makes me look less puffy. I'm really puffy this morning. I did not eat good yesterday. Okay, and then I'm gonna take the same color with this bigger brush. And honestly, this is the bright brush, but I could use the eyeshadow brush too. This one just has kind of more of a cone shape, and I kind of like that. I love this sort of, yes. Chai is so favorite. I love this color. I use this color probably 99% of the time as a base, just because it's not too light to where it, you know, makes me look like I'm going for a very like distinct crease, but it's also not too dark. So it just really does look good on everyone, and it's a really good summer color. Okay, so in the picture, she does have a lighter color on her brow bone. So I'm gonna probably use a highlight to do that, because I don't really want to use anything powdery on my brow bone. It's so good. Chai is just so good. And I haven't seen anyone it doesn't look good on. Even my darker, more melanin rich women look so pretty in it, because it just has enough warmth in it. Okay, so then she has like this cute wing. So we're gonna see if we can do this. I don't like doing wings, and I especially don't like doing them on camera. But here we are. And just remember, I'm not even close to being done with my face makeup. Okay, so I'm just gonna take Stay Spray. not first, because if you do that, your makeup will, your eyeshadows will start to cake, and you'll have to start to like break them down. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take Trust, and I'm just gonna apply it to this multitasker, and then I'm gonna take my Stay Spray, and I'm just gonna kind of pinch it a little bit. See if I can't get a cute little wing, or if Leo's ruined this brush. Let's all find out right now. So what I like to do is just utilize the shape of the brush. That is not as sharp as I want it to be. Pinch it again. And I just like faking wings. I don't like real wings on me. I love them on other people. But for some reason, and I always like to take my finger and kind of rub it upward like this toward the edge of my corner of my brow. Just like so. Nothing crazy. Same thing over here. And you're always gonna have like one eye that's easier than the other, and it's not always because your hands do better on one side. It has a lot to do with bone structure. So technically, my bone structure just is more fun on this side. Fingers crossed for wings. You're brave. Seriously. Bright wings are just like, if it were just a technical thing, you guys, it would be one thing, but it's not. It's a structure thing. So if I wanted to do a wing on someone else with the right structure, I could do it no problem. My structure is not built for such things. Okay, I think that's good. Honestly, that's a cooler color than she had in the, I wonder if I just used cocoa on accident. I'm gonna just add a little Philly to warm that up, because I do not want it. My nose is gonna start running right on camera. I'm gonna add Philly to this. Oh, good. Thank you. It's looking okay. I think the key is just really kind of taking that finger and in it, and you can just, I don't know, if you don't like licking your face, don't do this. It reminds me of like, I feel like, do moms do that still, or have we evolved? Because I kind of still sometimes will do it, but it's very rare for my little kid, and I'll feel really weird about it. But it's better than them having like peanut butter on their face, right? Okay. So we got our little wing going on. Pretty. If you want to soften that even more, like let's say you blew it, but you still want the look, you can always come in with just like a little darker, this one. Like I can come in with a little bit of basic and just kind of soften that. As long as it looks pretty, that's really all I care about. I want it to look slept in and pretty. Thank you, Jamie. No long time, no see. Okay, so that's really all she has on her eyes. And then she has like this very distinct matte, it's kind of just medium nude lips. So I'm gonna come in with this. What brush do I want? Let's just use the other side of my multitasker. And I'm just gonna come in with a contour. I'm gonna use Astoria. And I know I already did this. I just want it to be very crispy right there. Pretty, okay. So then I'm just take Ibiza. Do I wanna take Ibiza or do I wanna go with how matte, how nude do I wanna go? This is another thing about nudes that I think is interesting. Okay, ballerina, it is. Yeah, I know the latte makeup trend. You ain't wrong. Okay, so in order to do a good nude lip, these are your suggestions right here. Are number one being moisturize your lips the night before. And if you can exfoliate them, even better, because nude, like a true nude, meaning like a nude lip, essentially means nothing's on it, right? So when I talk about a nude lip, I like to say that it's like a nude as in the color nude, which I know has got a lot of different colors because everyone's nude, something that makes sense. I would say it would be just like a skin color. Remember when we used to do that? And I don't know if you guys are this old, but in the 90s, or you're probably like, I don't know if you hit right then when we were doing the whole Janet Jackson thing, but that is what is coming back into style. So, for a minute. So that was ballerina. But if you have trouble with nudes, like if everything goes orange on you, you wanna look for a nude with a purple undertone. So you can see all of my lip and cheeks have purple undertones because everything goes orange on me. Yes, concealer over the lip with lip gloss on top, absolutely. And then brown eyeliner. We would use a brown eyeliner to line the lip. Super cool. We're being cooler about it now, but we're still doing basically the same thing. So, okay. So, now I'm just going to actually come in with my foundation in quotations. So far you guys, my favorite brush right now is the blend brush, and I have two of them, and I use one for blush and eyeshadow a lot of the time. And then I use one for my foundation. That's me, a nude has to be purple tone. Yep. So ballerina, Ibiza is actually such a good color because it's very neutral. I've never seen a color look so good on so many people as Ibiza. So if you don't have that one in your palette, you really need to get that color in your palette. It's such a good one. If you don't sell that one a lot, try selling it a little bit more. You're gonna love it. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna do my under eyes and then I'll work my way through the rest of the stuff I wanna cover. So I'll start with under eyes. What I like to do is come in with OR and I like to do a tiny wash. For me, and let me just tell you why, and I'll actually show you why. Okay, can you guys see how much yellow and green is under my eye naturally? So when I come in with the pink, it will just kind of neutralize that for me, and I really, really like that being neutralized. Honestly, not everyone has this problem. I would say, rarely do people have this problem where they have a light under eye already but it's kind of greenish yellow. Will always be one of my favorites. Ballerina is killer. Ballerina is so good because it's so nude in a purpley way. Whereas a lot of your nudes are gonna be, you know, I dare say that people would call that Charlotte Tilbury color a nude, and that looks so orange on me. So it really is, color is everything, and the better you guys get with color theory, the better artist you're going to be. And I have no actual questions about that. That's just a flat out fact. Okay, so I'm gonna do just a little editing under my under eye. And really, if you haven't tried, you said you do a quick wash. Did I say OR? I didn't mean OR. I meant R1, I think. Yeah, R1. Also, VR1 is really pretty for that. But you can, and when I say wash, you guys, I'm not talking about a lot of product. Like, you cannot see that. I'm just utilizing the color, not the texture. So I'm utilizing the color to tone. I'm not going in to cover anything. So just when someone does a wash with Demi, that's a really good thing to remember, is they're not utilizing the coverage. They're utilizing the color. Okay, so I'm gonna do this just straight in the camera. And I just took OR3. Let's see, not OR3. I think it's just O3. Yeah, it's O3. And I'm just going to tackle. What in the world just happened? This is the joy of live video. I don't do them very often, and there's a reason. But I like them because, like, to me, live video breaks that fourth wall like nothing else. Because, and when I talk about the fourth wall, it's this screen is your fourth wall. And so when you are willing to go live, you're taking down that fourth wall and just connecting with your audience. So I don't think that live video will ever go out of style. I think the only time live video is not being utilized correctly is when you're using it as a video and not as a way to connect. I love Audrey too. Audrey's so good. Just a smidge. R1 got it, yes. Sorry, I said that wrong, Caitlin. Many noobs look orange on me. Yes, so if you're like me that way, then yeah. Okay, so I'm just taking this color. And honestly, I would be using a smaller brush right now if Leo hadn't done arts and crafts yesterday. And I just really just found out about it. Okay. So I'm just going where anything is dark, and you can do this in a magnifying mirror if your eyes are bad. I wouldn't recommend, if your eyes are bad, doing it on a phone, but you could still do it if you just kind of squint and look for those darker spots. I'm going after the darkest of spots real quick under my eyes. The best way to sell Demi, in my opinion, is by doing a little bit of Demi. Because I think people are willing, they're willing to listen for a short amount of time when it comes to Demi. So you guys can see that crease, right? So if I come and very deliberately get just that crease, and I don't blend out, to me, blending out is blending outward. I'm gonna blend into the skin, so I'm just gonna kind of press it into the skin in the right area. And hopefully. Okay, so I got rid of the blue. Now what I gotta do is I gotta brighten it up a little bit next to it. So I'm using a one next to it. And watch it just kind of disappear. I don't want to use that because I use that for eyeshadow. I love the black brushes, but the problem with them, the one problem with them, is you don't know if something's on them or not. Am I right? Okay. That's as good as it's going to get in my phone, I think, without adding way too much product. I've been dabbling in Demi a lot. More and actually sharing about it, kicking myself for not sharing 2 years ago. Honestly, Caitlin, you're not alone in that. And honestly, like, it does take it for a lot of people, it takes seeing it over and over and over again before you can adapt to it. And so a lot of reasons that's why we end up just doing what everyone else is doing, because we see it so much. And so if people are doing something wrong, just gonna take one and just kind of start getting rid of these little red spots. So don't feel weird about that, because that is totally normal, and it's not something to, like, you just weren't ready, and that's how most people were. I would say most people weren't ready, but I honestly feel like also it was delivered too quickly, and like there was too much pressure around it, that I think I just want to turn my brush around. Hold on, I'm gonna clean it properly so I can just turn it around. So don't stress it, but just it really is so good for certain things that just can't be done otherwise. And you know, my goal is to at least get everyone using Demi under their eyes. That's really my only goal with Demi. And then, you know, work your way to whatever you want to work your way to. Because I do feel like there is a lot of people out there. There are a lot of people out there who just don't want to think about it. They don't have time to think about it. And our whole... you know, our whole shtick with our company there for so long was fast, easy makeup. And so that's the reason everyone had a hard time kind of adopting it. And so I don't think that everyone needs to adopt it. I don't think that, like I said, just baby steps. As long as you're willing to learn, I think that the color theory is so good for every part of this, of being a makeup artist. You know, it's just art. So you guys can see this little dark guy right here. So I'm going to take a little bit of the R1. It's a little bit of a freckled area. Get rid of that. What colors are you using around your mouth? Okay, so the three colors I'm really using, this one, and that one, which are 001, 03, and R1. Yeah. So my mouth has a lot of freckling. So anytime you're going after freckling, you want to go into the pinks. Anytime you're going after rosacea, a lot of times you're going to want to go into the yellows and the oranges. And I blend my demi and blay and put on my... I don't think you're alone in that, Adrian. So, honestly, you'd be better off just going right into... your 3D situation. And there's nothing wrong with that. Like I really hate this idea that there's right and wrong There are some very clear rules to light and dark and to what's going to do what. Okay, so if there are some very clear rules to that. That being said, I want you to take a peek at like that color, for example, and see how close it is to this color. So the really it's about the placement too. And honestly, our colors and the reason they've always worked so well and always been so popular is because a lot of them counteract the color theory that we already had with 3D and have with 3D is a lot of demi color theory. It's just that back then, Kara just kind of knew it worked, but she didn't know exactly why it worked. She just knew it worked. And so she's getting to where she's understanding, okay, this is why this works and this is why this works. And, you know, she's working on creating lots of fun products for us for those reasons. But it doesn't mean that like, so I'm gonna, just to prove it to you, I'm just gonna come in here with aura on this side. And I'm gonna kind of haphazardly kind of attack, just like see how I'm not gonna go on this spot that's already light, but I'm gonna kind of haphazardly apply aura here. Just in these dark areas. And this is just to prove to you guys that it's a lot about technique with these creams and the placement. It's not all like we have good colors. So it's not like demi is superior to 3D. They're very similar in texture. They're very similar. It's just that you're gonna get there quicker with less product. But you can get there with 3D as well. So this isn't really a video to like teach people not to use 3D. I love 3D. I'm just saying you have to decide what your target audience is, what you like, what is your jam, and go with that. So if your jam is quick makeup and blending out and all of that, then go start with 3D, save your audience money, save them time. But I want to show you guys something just for, because this is teaching, this isn't just me doing a demo. Say I take a bigger brush and I go in and I use, let's just go with aura because I was already using this, and I take it and I just swipe it through here. It looks beautiful. Like, it doesn't, these colors are fantastic. It's just that the older I get, the less I want to look like I have just this one color, because I feel like it just draws too much attention to certain things. So I just try to kind of go in and kind of dab and find those spots, but really in the camera and in the camera, it's going to look really pretty. And in real life, it's going to look really pretty. It's just that the more product I use in this area and the more I smile and move throughout the day, I may end up, see how just doing that, I may end up with just a little more product than I want to in certain areas, because the product is going to naturally, every product is going to naturally do that. Whereas if I use less product over on this side, and take a little bit more time, it's going to, you know, I will be able to not have that happen towards the end of the day. So let me just, I'm just going to kind of come in and do this quicker than I normally would, but just with Demi. I just want you guys to, like, I want you guys to understand that it's not one versus the other. It's just, what do you want out of your makeup? And I think that was a real problem, is that one versus the other mentality, because I think it kind of created this rift that I didn't love. Of like, oh, I gotta pick and I gotta, you know, and I hated that. So, okay, so I'm just gonna show you the difference with taking just a little bit of product and placing it in the right spots versus just taking and swiping. It is very much a preference thing at this point, because for me, I kind of like that I can see my skin and I can see, you know, the luminosity of my skin on this side. And then that's preference. A lot of people prefer this side of my skin because it looks smoother and it looks like one color and it's something that they're after. Either way, these creams are going to get you wherever you want to go. It's not, you know, right or wrong. That's all I wanted to kind of prove with that, is it's not really right or wrong. It's just a matter of what you want and how much time you want to spend doing whatever you're doing. So can you guys kind of see the difference? I just kind of love, yeah, I'm with Caitlin. I love them both for different reasons. I love the fast easiness of this side, and I love the luminosity of this side. And so it really is like, you kind of have to decide what's most important to you, is the speed and the blendability and the quickness. And that's why in my color match form, I really do ask, you know, what are you after? Because both sides are so pretty. And so it's kind of just one of those things where you kind of have to just decide for yourself and not be worried about what other people are doing, but also be open to, oh, look, I found it. Be open to the fact that maybe there's something new to learn here. I wish I had a darker, anyway, just understanding that you can broaden your horizons, really, is kind of what I like to think about when I think about Demi and 3D, and that is why I have them both in here, because I'll change my mind, I'll change my mood for the day. But to be clear, you will not put a main highlight over your already placed Demi. Yes, to be clear, and especially if you're wanting to do your, you know, a service for your customer, you don't want to teach them to layer. The less layering, the better. Always. Especially the older people get, the less layering, the better. So you want to use the right colors where they belong. And that's kind of why I kind of came up with that camo method, because I feel like if people are using the right colors where they belong, they're going to have a better shot at it. That being said, there are a lot of artists who go in with their lightest color first and end with, you know, their contour and all of that, and it looks beautiful. So I just feel like that just is a testament to the ease and versatility of these cream products. And it's also a testament of just that lack of oxidation, and that it looks the closest to skin that any other product, any other modality. It just works so much better than any other modality. I don't know if you guys know this. This is really interesting. But do you guys remember like how, and I mean, she's still just absolutely gorgeous, but J-Lo used to have a makeup artist. What was his name? Oh, I can't remember his name. Anyway, he used creams. He always used creams on her. And I don't know what, someone Google this for me. What is his name? It's gonna bug me. Chris, no, not Chris. Anyway, doesn't matter. And everyone just died over the way her skin looked and how her skin would always look glowy. And he lived in, what is his name? It just like is on the tip of my tongue. I'll start talking and then the name will come to my mind and then I'll like think about it and it'll go away. Anyway, he swore by creams, but he never really created a product per se. But he had a whole book about creams and why creams were so versatile and beautiful and they're the best thing ever. And it was Scott Barnes. Thank you, Danielle. Scott Barnes. And anyway, creams, I don't know if you guys remember Kevin Aquin. I don't know how you say his name. I have his books. I've had his books since I was a little girl. He was big into creams as well, but he died before he could create a product. They did create a product. They created a homage to him, but it never did that well. Kevin Aquin, yeah. It never did that well, but he wasn't J-Lo. Scott Barnes was J-Lo's makeup artist, and he used only creams, swore by creams. I don't know if he ever did come out with creams. I kind of like lost track of him. Do you guys know? But either way, it really is true that creams are the best, absolute best out there as far as products go, and we shouldn't be looking for a new product. If something's not working, it's because the color is wrong. You're using the wrong color in the wrong spot. So like, for example, if you're seeing a lot of texture, your color is probably too light. If you're seeing a lot of color, your color's too dark. These are very simple fixes. And what I love so much about it is there's just so many options for colors. And so that's why I'm always like, get your, you know, if you're not gonna do demi, get your customer to buy three colors. And the reason I do this and the reason I sell three colors to my customer is because I know that no matter what, she's going to have what she needs. So if she gets a little tan, she's gonna have what she needs. If she gets a little rosacea flare up, she's gonna have what she needs. If she gets a little blemish, she's gonna have what she needs. And also, if I get the color match wrong, let's say I get the color match wrong, most likely she's gonna have two out of three colors that work for her. And so then while she's waiting to swap out that other color, she has what she needs. Can you talk about how you close up a video when you're selling? Okay. Yes. So basically, I think that I think everyone has different selling styles. My selling style is really just kind of a very, I feel like what I have to do is I have to find confidence within a product. And once that confidence is there, I have no problem selling it because my belief system is so solidified within that product. And that's kind of why I wanted to talk about this today, because I feel like I'm starting to see the trends start to cycle again. And so the trends have cycled to where now we're back to BB and CC creams. And if, you know, I'm smart enough to remember that those never worked for me and they still won't work for me because they're the same product. They're just repackaged, renamed, reproduced, whatever they've added something that makes it easier to sell or whatever they've done, but the product remains the same. So for me, Jamie, to just go forever, it's more about having confidence in what I'm selling than the selling aspect of it. So I think that what happens is if you believe in a product and you believe in your modality and you believe in what you're selling, All of the rest follows it. So that's why I try very hard not to sell products I don't love, even if we make them. Like, say we make something and I don't love it, I usually will not sell it, just because I know that that is my way of selling, is belief. That belief system is my core. It's the core to how I sell. So my belief system really is, I believe in creams. I love creams. I believe that color is everything. And I also believe that there aren't like 1,001 different ways that you have to do your makeup in order to look pretty. So if you notice, like if you follow me, you'll notice that I don't change it up a ton. I'm very kind of narrow in what I will do on my own face, just because I don't do makeup as a artistic outlet in that way of like sparkles and shimmers and things like that. But if you are, that goes back to that belief system of why you do makeup. And so maybe why you do makeup is because it's fun and it's exciting and you love seeing color. And that's why I can't say enough that this isn't a game of right or wrong. This isn't a game of like, okay, if I just do it like Rachel does it, then I'll be whatever. I'll have a huge team or whatever. It's the key to the kingdom is really like, what do I love and believe, and what do I love to sell, and how do I love to sell it? And so I will always stand by a person for doing that, as long as they're being completely honest with their customer about something. And then what I'll normally try to do is always explain why I love something, not just that I love it. So, you know, if I had not done this last minute, I would probably have a better spiel. But like, for example, like if I were going to sell this brush, it would be why I love this brush. It wouldn't be just, this brush is so great, you got to go get it. It would be, let me tell you why this brush is great. These bristles are long. They're long and they're not dense. They're not dense. Okay, that's what I'm looking for. There's not as many bristles in this brush as there are in this brush. There just aren't. And so the less amount of bristles, the less product you're going to apply. So how I would sell this brush is I would probably sell this to beginners, and I would talk about how when you're beginning with your makeup, you want to try to find brushes that are loosely bound and long, so that you have a lot of versatility and a lot of room to mess up. Same with this brush, same thing here. This is why this is such a good eyeshadow brush for most people, is because you can't mess up a lot with this brush. And even with this side, like if you're going in to do an eyeliner with this side, you're gonna have a lot more ease and versatility as opposed to trying to use something like this. So I get it, people buy from me because of what I love, and they like me. They buy from you because they relate to you and like you. Exactly. And that's the beauty of the artist program. That's why I love the artist program so freaking much, is because I feel like it's what is better than buying from the girl next door? Literally, you're literally buying from the girl next door. And I think that's why it's so important that we stay being the girl next door. And what I mean by that is we continue to be honest about what we love, and we don't, you know, I think it's sad, but I think that influencers have become the new movie stars. Remember when we used to watch like the Pantene Pro-V commercials, and you'd be like, yeah, right, you do not use Pantene Pro-V, you're beautiful though, and I'll put up with this because I love your movies. So we all know Jennifer Aniston doesn't use Pantene Pro-V, but, or whoever, I don't know. But we'll put up with it because we love Jennifer Aniston, because we love her movies. This is theory. I don't, whatever. I think the problem, there's something that's weird that's happened where then bloggers came in, bloggers, influencers came in, and they were like the girl next door. They were going to tell us the truth. They were going to tell us what they really use. They were going to tell us why they really use it. They were going to show us what they do every day that makes them pretty. And they were just pretty enough and just fun enough and just nice enough and just like us enough that we ate it up. Like we ate it up because it was what we needed for our, you know, it was what we were missing. And now people have become influencers in order to make money, and they don't care anymore about being that girl next door. They don't care anymore about giving us the goods. They just want to show us what's out there. And I think there's a place for that, and that's fine. But I'll just see these big TikTokers, and everyone wants to know, everyone, the main question they'll always get is, but what do you use? Like, what do you use? What foundation is your favorite? And it's almost like they don't even want to tell you that because they want the brand deals and they want more people to, you know. And so I feel like as artists, and the culture that I love is just to keep it in that realm of like, I'm honest. I'm going to tell you what I use. I'm going to only sell you what I use. I'm going to show you, like, it's fine to show off an eyeshadow that you use once a year, but like, if you're just showing a new product every 5 minutes, I don't really think that's what the general public really wants. I think they'll put up with it here and there, but I can't tell you how many times I've just watched an influencer, and when I'm talking these big, big influencers, and these people are just like, just tell me what you use. And yeah, agreed. So I just feel like we can't become that. It doesn't matter how many followers you end up having. It's something I love about Harmony is she never talks about a product that she doesn't personally use and buy. And I just love the ethics of that. I just think it's so, that's the right word. Anyway, I just think it's something that we're losing that I don't want to lose. So that's kind of where I'm at with my sales game, is I'm here to help. And the other thing, the last thing I'll say, and then I'm 10 minutes over because I went on a huge soapbox, but I think it was a good one. So thanks, Jamie, because I think it needs to be said. Kind of like what comes first, the brand deal or the love of the product, then sharing it. Exactly. So like if you, for example, someone sent me, I get sent some things sometimes. I'm not like, you know, I'm not getting sent things all the time. And I don't really love getting sent things all the time unless I'm interested in them. But because I just feel like I don't like the waste either. I don't like waste. And if I get sent something and I let's say the box intrigues me enough to open it up, and then let's say I actually use it, a lot of times I will talk about it. Even if I got that product for free, that doesn't really matter. Like even if you're getting paid to talk about something, that doesn't matter as long as it's something that you actually love. I don't think there's anything wrong with, you know, getting your bag. I just think that what's wrong is if you're talking about something and selling something that you don't believe in. I think that will come around to bite you later. Or, you know, people just won't trust you like they trust someone else. And so that's kind of key. The confidence and the honesty are really, in my opinion, key. And then on top of that is, are you having fun? Are you having fun doing what you're doing or not? And if you're not having fun, then that's a genuine question you need to ask yourself as to why. Thank you for saying that. I think this is why, let me see. Yes, okay. You'll go with the video selling versus in-person selling. I get worried because of what is happening out there. I never want to come off not genuine. Yeah, you just got to ignore what's happening out there. And you just have to be you. I used to think that too. Like in the beginning, I would be like, I'm such a good seller in person, but I can't sell online. Why? And I think it's just because I was looking at too many people doing it a way I wouldn't do it. And I thought that was how I had to do it. And turns out it's just not. And turns out, you know, people, maybe they won't believe you. Maybe they will think that you're just doing it for the money. That's on them. Because if you're not, then it's really just on them. So try to kind of, what I would do is I just kind of make a list of what you love. And it doesn't have to be what Rachel loves or what anybody you follow loves. I want you to really dig deep and just be like, what do I love about makeup? What do I love about this product? What do I love about, what are the brushes I love and why do I love them? Like, start really digging in. You're welcome, Adrian. I try. I'm not, you know, perfect, but I do try. So once you figure that out, once you figure out what draws you to do makeup, you'll have so much more fun with it. And when you're having fun and you have a belief system set in place, you really can't miss. I don't think you can miss as long as you can get people to listen to you. But I feel like that'll all come in time. And that, like I said, that's all about a belief and it's all about, am I having fun with what I'm doing? And that's it. So I hope this helped. And I hope it kind of gives you kind of a new lease on creams. I know that, you know, it really is hard. I've even ran into that where I'm just like, whoa, do we need to make a tinted moisturizer? Is that where we're at? But I just always go back to the fact that no, we don't. And we don't have to be the same as other makeup companies. We don't have to rebrand every 10 years and bring back the old stuff. You guys, if I'm being real, like, people are putting their makeup on with their fingers now, right? Tell me you don't remember your mom shaking that bottle of foundation. And if you were bougie, you had the little sponges from, like, you know, those little pie shaped sponges. If you were bougie, you had those. If you are not bougie, you just put your makeup on with your fingers, because that's what most people did. They shook their makeup up, like, with the lid on it. I remember this. And then they just dab, 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 you know, dab, dab, dab. And then you would put the, you know, finish it off with your fingers. And then now I'm seeing also powder puffs. You guys, powder puffs. Like, we had powder, like, my grandma used powder puffs. So if you don't think that is the beauty industry trying to keep you buying, acting like this is a new idea of some sort. It's not new. Nothing about that is new. It is old as time. It all comes back around. So it's just like fashion. Makeup is just like fashion. It'll come and it'll go. But if you have found something that works, you don't have to get sucked into that. And you don't have to let your clients and customers and friends and neighbors, you don't have to let them get sucked back into that. Honestly though, like, if a powder puff was always the way to go back to a powder puff. Like, if that was always the way to go. But I'm just saying, keep your mind clean. Like, we've had powder puffs before. We used to use our fingers all the time to put makeup on. These are the kinds of things I just want you kind of thinking about so that you can understand that, oh my gosh, I don't have to follow every single trend that comes along. I can actually do what I need to do and get the best results with the best products. And that's kind of where, you know, where I want you guys to be. So anyway, that was the longest spiel of my life. I hope I helped you in some way today. But I'm gonna make sure I didn't miss any comments, and then I'm gonna hop off because I definitely talked too much. Okay. Oh, Caitlin, I didn't see this comment about your kids. I was just going to say my kids freak when I lick my fingers to wipe something off their face. I feel like when we were kids, it was like, that's just mom. Like, I don't get to say anything about that. And now our kids, like, Leo lets me do it. I don't know. I don't do it very often. Okay. All right, you guys, I will talk to you later. I love you so much. Bye-bye.